glad to be back in the class again. We still meet, but as we can see now, it's going to be tough to do that. Still going to be delayed, but this week is the Sermon on the Mount. It's three chapters, and Miss Lori's going to do her best to get it done in 15, 20 minutes. But basically, it's about the Beatitudes, about being supremely blessed and happy. That's pretty much what that's about. It's your character. Then how do we influence the world with salt and light? So you're going to go through that. And then he tells us, this is Jesus preaching on the mountain, we're still to obey the law, even though we need to do it for the right reasons, not to be religious, but we need to do it to obey God and please him. And then we get into how we're supposed to pray and give. We're not supposed to do it boastfully or to make it like we're it, that we're important. We're doing it to please God. How we're going to pray. And when we give, try not to be like, let it be known to everybody that I did this. That's not the reason we do it. And then we're supposed to collect treasures, not the important things that we think, like cars and houses, but we'll collect treasures for heaven. That's pretty much what she's going to get into. And welcome, Miss Lori.
All right. Good morning, preteens. This has been one of the hardest lessons to plan because the Sermon on the Mount, we could teach this, we could spend a month on it and not hit everything that we want to hit on this. This is all Jesus. All of his preaching and teaching and one of the most important sermons that you see in all the Bible, because it really tells us how we are to live as followers of Jesus. So I've got over here a jar. Okay, you see my jar? In my jar on the bottom is water. I know my water, it's actually purple, it's really dark. And on the top is oil. And what do you know about oil and water? Right, they don't mix. Okay, so that's why the water is on the bottom and the oil is on the top. Okay, they're in the same jar, but they're separate. Okay, now Jesus says that we are to be in the world, but not of the world. And so if we think of the world as this jar, then, you know, we've got two distinct parts right here, okay? If we are this top layer, we are in the world, but we are not of the world. Now, does that mean that we never interact with anybody else that's not a Christian? No, absolutely not, because we have to if we want to make disciples of Jesus. And we do that. So if I mix my jar, what happens? Is it mixed up? Yes, it's mixed up. We're all together right now, but if you'll notice, and I'll put it down here, and we can already see it a little bit, it starts to separate again, okay? Because again, we're in the world, but we're not of the world. And so think about that today when I'm going through some of these important lessons in the Sermon on the Mount. Now, I am not going to be able to go through all three of these chapters, Matthew 5 through 7, but I'm going to encourage you this week to read through all of them. Jesus talks about many, many different topics in the Sermon on the Mount. And in order for you to know what they are, you kind of have to read through them. But when you read them, don't think, oh, I can't read this Bible by myself. I can't understand it. You can, okay? Jesus puts this out there in plain words. And so you need to go through and just really read. I'm going to hit some of the high points of it and kind of talk about the overall meaning and what he was trying to let the disciples know and the crowds. But in order for you to really get all of it, it would be that's a good part for you to go through and read. It's almost all red letters. And what do red letters mean in your Bible? It means that Jesus is the one that's speaking. And so Jesus speaking, what do we need to do? We need to listen. So we're going to listen to what Jesus has to say today. So if we look in this Matthew chapter 5, I'm going to start with just verses 1 and 2. It says, "Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them." So who is his audience for the Sermon on the Mount? It tells us right here. Right, it's the disciples. And what are disciples? They're the people that are followers of Jesus. And so really, this message is for the people that are following Jesus. They're for the disciples. Now, that doesn't mean there's not other people there, because where Jesus is going these days, what are people doing? They're following him. And so where he's speaking specifically to his disciples, there are others listening as well. So let's see. I want you to think first about the word righteous. We hear the word righteous a lot in the Bible. If we think about back to Noah was, God told him he was the only righteous man during that time. And so righteousness basically means that we are morally right, that we're free from guilt or sin. And that freedom from guilt and sin comes through Jesus. And so we're looking for that type of righteousness. So if we're born again believers in Jesus Christ, then we're righteous in his eyes. And so overall, this sermon is teaching about what it means to be righteous in the sight of God. Okay, so he starts out with these things called Beatitudes. Okay, Beatitudes, like Mr. Don told us, are like blessings. But what word do you also hear in beatitude? Do you hear the word attitude? Yeah, so think about your attitude as we're going through these. And there's really about four attitudes that are described that need to be in our lives today. So verse 3 says, "Blessed are those who are poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Now, poor in spirit means being humble. Okay, so if you are humble, yours is the kingdom of heaven. And we're giving God the glory, and we're not giving it to ourselves. And that goes with the attitude towards ourselves. What's our attitude towards ourselves? Are we humble or are we boastful? Okay. So the second one, read in verses 4 through 6, is the attitude toward our sin. It says, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger for thirst and for righteousness, for they will be filled." And so, you know, this is kind of our attitude towards our sins. We should mourn over sin and hate it, and then also meekly submit to God. Sometimes that word meek doesn't always have a positive connotation or a positive meaning, but here it is. Meekness is not weak. It's how we use It's how we know that our power is not ours. It comes from God. And so it's how we are guided by the Holy Spirit. And we should hunger and thirst for righteousness. We should want what is right in our lives. And we should seek that out. The third set of Beatitudes is in verses 7 through 9. And it's our attitude towards the Lord. And so it says, "Blessed are those who are merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure of heart, for they will see God. And blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God." So we experience God's mercy when we trust in him, and he gives us a clean heart and peace within when we do that. And since we've been given his mercy, we can then share that mercy with other people. And we seek to keep our hearts pure so we can see God in our lives. And we become peacemakers in a troubled world so we can show the love of God to others. There's a lot of people right now that need to see the love of God, as there always is, but especially from us. There's so many different things going on, and if we can be peacemakers and we can show them that peace comes from Jesus, then we can change others' lives as well. And our last one in 10 through 11 is our attitude towards the world. It says, "Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were also before you." This is a tough one, okay? The world is not kind to Christians a lot of time. They don't understand. They don't understand why we believe what we believe. And they might insult us, and they might persecute us. They might put us down, and it doesn't feel good. But God never promised us an easy life, but he did promise he would never leave us. And so it says that our reward is going to be great in heaven for us continuing to live a righteous life through Jesus Christ. And so these Beatitudes If we hold those, they result in us being salt and light. Now let's talk about what it means to be salt and light. If you think about salt, what does it do? You know, if you eat a French fry without salt, what does it taste like? Is it good? It's kind of bland, isn't it? Kind of tastes, I mean, it's still a French fry. I guess you could dip it in some ketchup and make it better, but what really makes it better? What? You get that salt shaker and you shake it a little bit on the French fries, and that enhances the flavor. And so, and it's that way with a lot of different foods. Even if, you know, you're baking cookies, do you put salt in cookies? Yeah, you do, because it enhances the flavor. That's one thing it does. It also preserves things. It also keeps them from spoiling. And that's what people in Bible times used it mostly for, as a preservative, so that food and different things would not spoil. And so salt was very, very valuable. And in these verses right here, in verse 5, chapter 5, verses 13, and actually just verse 13, talks about us being salt. And so Jesus says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot." So Jesus is telling us we're the salt of the earth, okay? If you take a big bite of salt, is it going to taste good? No, it's not. It is there to enhance and to make things better. It's there to make it a little bit more valuable. So, you know, we want to affect things positively. Just like that salt affects those French fries and makes them better, we want to affect this world. And what do we want to do? We want to make it better, and we want to make Jesus Christ known. So the second thing he tells us is that we are light. Okay, it says, "You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and give it light for everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." When you're riding, if you've been on an airplane before and you are flying over a city, can you see that city brightly? If it's nighttime, yes, you can see lots of light down there. But if you're flying over the country, you really can't see anything. And so what Jesus wants us to be like is a city. He wants us to shine brightly in a dark world. And then give that glory to him. He wants us to show that light and, you know, and just to be that for other people. And that's really, really important for us. We need to be the salt, and we need to be the light, okay? So those are the first few verses of chapter 5 and the beginning of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Now I'm just going to go through some different parts. I'm not going to go through word for word, or this video would be an hour, and you probably weren't paying attention to me. So we're going to hit some highlights, but again, I want you to go back and read through and see what Jesus had to say. So we're going to skip down to chapter 5, verse 20, because this talks about that righteousness we were talking about at the beginning, and it says, "For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven." Now, remember, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, they're the ones that are teaching the Old Testament. So you're like, well, why does it need to surpass that? Well, the Pharisees' righteousness was a lot of times superficial. It was just on the outside. They were doing things and saying things and teaching things so that they looked good, okay? They were not giving that glory to God. And so it was a superficial righteousness, where Jesus tells us our righteousness needs to be internal. It needs to come from the heart. And you'll see as we go through a lot that he tells us to do a lot of things in secret. You know, if we are forming a relationship with somebody, a lot of times we're not doing it out for everybody to see. We're doing that in private. And so he tells us many times throughout the scripture that, you know, he says, go into a room by yourself. Spend some time with me. And so we're seeing that throughout this. And so instead of like a superficial, look what I can do, it's an internal type of righteousness. So I want you to go to Matthew 5. 43 through 45. And this is where Jesus is talking about loving your enemies. And it says, you have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. That's a tough thing to do. Okay, but Jesus tells us that we're to love our enemies, not just the people that are easy to love, but the people that are hard to love too. So if we skip down to Matthew chapter 6, verse 6, this is where he talks about prayer and he teaches about prayer. And in 6:6 he says, but when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And if you continue going on with these verses, he goes into what we know as the Lord's Prayer and shows us how we're supposed to pray and gives us that example. But basically, you know, this means when you pray, and when we pray, we're talking to Jesus. When we go in and talk to Jesus, we're to do that on our own, by ourselves. And there's a time and a place for us to pray all together. We'll pray in just a few minutes before we dismiss. But there's also a time for you to say the words and for you to have those words to Jesus so that you are having that conversation with him. And that's very, very, very important. And so take some time every day to spend some time with Jesus in prayer. Matthew 6, 19 through 21 says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up yourselves treasures in heaven where moths and vermins do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And so this is saying, you know, we see lots of people that have lots of stuff, okay? And Jesus tells us we don't need all that stuff here on earth, okay? That's not what we need. Our treasure needs to be in heaven. So what are we doing with our money? Are we giving it to things that will make an eternal difference? Or are we buying a bunch of stuff we really don't need? So think about those things as you're spending, as you get money and you're spending money. What are you doing with it? Matthew 6, 33 through 34. We got a couple more I want us to look at. It says, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble on its own. There's a lot these days that we are speculating might happen with schools and with our things opening, or some things are shutting, and we just worry about the future. And what I've really had to think about, and I've thought about this a whole lot this week, is that there is nothing that I can do at all in worrying. Okay, worrying's not going to solve one thing. We've got to trust that that God's going to work everything out for his glory and our good. And so if we get up each day and we think, okay, God, I know that you have this, but there's no need for us to worry. And so keep that in mind. That's a great verse for us to use right now. And the last one we're going to look at is we're going to flip to Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. Says, enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate and narrow is the road that leads to life, and only few find it. Okay, not everybody is going to become a child of God. And he says it's a pretty narrow gate. Okay, it's pretty skinny. And there's a wide gate that leads to destruction. And so we have to decide which gate we want to go through. If we want to make Jesus the Lord of our life, and we're going to just get through that narrow gate, or if we want to follow the world. And so, you know, this was a big verse for me, especially growing up. I would go back to and back to and back to, because sometimes it's hard when you see a lot of people going through that big gate and doing whatever they want to do. But know that your reward leads to life, that reward is in heaven with Jesus, and there's not going to be anything better than that, okay? Jesus continues to teach throughout chapter 7. He ends his sermon through that chapter, and we look at what it means to be inwardly righteous and follow hard after him. The very last verse in chapter 7 says, or the last two verses say, when Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching because he taught as one who had authority and not as their teacher of the law. So remember in the very beginning, who did we say that Jesus was teaching to? The disciples, right? But now in the very end, who's there? The crowd, okay? And the crowd was amazed because he didn't teach like everybody else, okay? It says he taught with what? With authority. And authority is that power, and that power comes from God. He taught differently, and they knew that they were hearing something that they'd never heard before, and that was something that was very different and very special for them. I skipped a lot of things in here that are great, great points, and we can learn so much from. And so I would encourage you to go back and read these verses this week, because these words are from Jesus, directly from him, and he has a lot that he needs to say to us. So I am glad that I was able to share this word again with you today. I'm looking forward to hopefully seeing you very soon, whenever that may be. We're not sure yet, and that's okay. We're going to keep praying that God shows us the right time to come back to Sunday school. In the meantime, know that I miss you and I love you. Mr. Don is going to come back up, and he's going to pray for us, and then we will see you next time.
One verse you said was very important to me. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble on its own. That's something, if we can just think about that every day, it will ease our hearts and not have to worry about things that's going to happen tomorrow. It's going to work out. Have faith in God. So I'm going to close this in prayer now. Lord, we just thank you for this lesson, Lord, that these three chapters, there's a lot there to teach us how we're to live, how we are to act with other people, how we're to love. And through your example and your teaching, Lord, we just thank you for that and this opportunity we have each week that we still get the message out, even though we can't meet in person. And we just love you and thank you. Amen.